really delighted that you've come out today for what promises to be a very good session. We'll have about a 30-minute talk and then opportunity for you to engage in a conversation with our guests. Today, I'm really pleased to be able to introduce you to a woman I've known for a long time and have admired her work in the public policy realm as it's grown over the years. Sarah has been an aide to Senator George Mitchell, which is when I first met her. She's gone on to years of excellent work at the Carr Center for Human Rights at Harvard University, the Kennedy School. She served in the Clinton administration as a Deputy Assistant Secretary for Peacekeeping, is that right? And most recently and currently, she's Undersecretary for Civilian Protection, I want to say, Civilian Security, Democracy and Human Rights in the U.S. State Department. So as we turn off our cell phones, turn down our cell phones, it's really a great pleasure to bring to you Sarah Sewall. So help me welcome Sarah Sewall, please.
Thank you, John. Thank you so much, John, and thanks also to MIT's Center for International Studies for bringing us together this afternoon. I have to say I am really gratified by the turnout here, and it's great to be back in Cambridge. It's great to be back with people who engage so deeply with ideas, and it's great to be back with people who engage so deeply with ideas so close to the holidays. So thank you very much for joining us. I do want to, as John said, leave lots of time for Q&A. So I'm going to dive right into the substance of my remarks today, which really reflect my experience over the last 3 years working in the Obama administration from the State Department perspective. So it was only 2 months ago that we marked the 15th anniversary of 9/11. And for a decade and a half now, the United States has been engaged in a far-reaching effort to protect American citizens and our allies from the threat of terrorism globally. We've devoted hundreds of billions of dollars to develop new military and intelligence capabilities, enabling the U.S. to strike terrorist operations and leaders in distant lands and to prevent untold violence against people across the globe. But few would argue that despite all of that effort, the threat of terrorism has actually receded. Indeed, many Americans feel no safer today than they did 15 years ago. And this is an unsettling reality that demands that all of us in the field of international security take a sober assessment of our approach to date. And if we compare where we are now with the period just following 9/11, the parallels are striking. 15 years ago this month, Operation Enduring Freedom in Afghanistan was well underway. Today, the United States once again leads a multinational coalition against a terror menace, this time in the form of Daesh, or ISIL. And once again, in the face of our military power, the terrorist group under pressure loses fighters and territory week by week. Pressure from the 67-nation coalition has caused Daesh to lose over half its territory in Iraq and over 10,000 square kilometers in Syria to date. Its flow of new recruits has dropped to its lowest level since the conflict began, and Daesh has been forced to resort to conscription to fill its ranks. Now, that progress may be clear, but that's also how it felt when the United States and the global coalition against al-Qaeda was at the height of its efforts to root al-Qaeda out of Afghanistan. So, to avoid repeating history, we remember a key lesson from the post-9/11 period, which is this. that military power can achieve tactical gains against terrorist threats, but it cannot defeat the violent ideologies or address the grievances that give rise to the terror networks in the first place. In other words, we have to pair our military efforts to defeat groups like Daesh with a comprehensive civilian-led effort to prevent the next Daesh. Otherwise, we'll remain stuck in what Secretary Kerry has called counterterrorism whack-a-mole. And while this may be an obvious lesson, it is not easy to apply. And the bulk of my remarks now will seek to explain why. It begins with the very nature of our understanding of how terror threats evolved over the last 15 years. And following 9/11, the United States and our allies devoted extraordinary resources to devastate the core of al-Qaeda leadership on the Afghanistan-Pakistan border. And as the U.S. targeted al-Qaeda, the group decentralized and dispersed, adopting new strategies to reconstitute its recruits, its resources, and its safe havens. Al-Qaeda remnants began portraying themselves to communities as protectors from ethnic, sectarian, or tribal opponents, or as saviors from an abusive and corrupt government, or as providers of basic services and employment. Elements loosened their ideological requirements to encourage new affiliates and solo attacks, allowing them to tap into a pre-existing criminal or insurgent network and to tap a broader set of grievances around the world. Consequently, an array of new terror groups emerged over the past 15 years, some linked to al-Qaeda, some maintaining a more independent character. Violent groups with roots in local conflicts and grievances began to coalesce and affiliate with a global jihadi movement. In 2006, a violent Salafist group rooted in the Algerian civil war united to form al-Qaeda in the Maghreb, or AQIM. In 2009, terrorist outfits in Saudi Arabia and Yemen fused into al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. And in 2012, al-Shabaab announced its allegiance to al-Qaeda, broadening its violent ambitions beyond Somalia to East Africa. Around the same time, al-Qaeda remnants in Iraq stoked Sunni anger over abuses and neglect under the former government, along with the chaos of the Syrian civil war, to reconstitute, to seize territory, and to declare a so-called Islamic State, or Daesh. And in doing so, Daesh emerged as a second pole in the global jihadi movement. And many terror groups across the globe then rebranded in turn to affiliate with this new entity. Boko Haram, for example, pledged allegiance to Daesh in 2015. And now we see instances of Daesh competing with al-Qaeda for affiliates, which has led to divided loyalties and even splintering among some terrorist groups. Stepping back, we see violent groups born of local resentments, whether resistance to foreign occupation and Western education, or perceptions of abuse and marginalization by governments. These violent groups begin to see themselves in the context of this global jihadi movement. And with that broader affiliation came a more dangerous set of ambitions, seizing territory, toppling regional governments, attacking Westerners, and organizing attacks in distant countries. Consequently, many of these groups now combine elements of a counterinsurgency with those of a global terrorist network. And as policymakers, our efforts to address this kind of threat must address this new reality. The U.S. has begun taking critical, albeit tentative, steps toward a more preventive approach to terrorism. We call it countering violent extremism, or CVE, and U.S. efforts have anchored a parallel international effort, which the United Nations often refers to as preventing violent extremism, or PVE. And these acronyms and terms are often used interchangeably. Now, at the heart of CVE, PVE is the recognition that the military defeat of today's terrorists is insufficient to kill that ideology or to address the broader factors that are essential to fueling new terror threats. In essence, CVE seeks to prevent the next generation of terror threats by helping the most vulnerable people and places resist terror recruitment and expansion, and equally important, to push governments to address the underlying grievances that violent extremists so often exploit. And in my mind, this represents both a profound and a much-needed shift in how the United States and the international community think and act about the challenge of terrorism. I want to spell out two different aspects of what we're trying to do with this countering violent extremism approach. First, the aim is to improve governance and to halt state policies that fan radicalization to violence. The second key element is building the resilience of communities that are most at risk for terrorist infiltration and expansion. So let me start by talking a little bit about governance. This is not typically a topic that is featured prominently in discussions about counterterrorism. And yet, as I suggested, what we've learned over the last 15 years is that we ignore the questions of the second and third order effects of the fight against terrorism and broader issues of governance at our peril if our goal is to prevent a new generation of violent extremists from emerging. When governments fail to protect their citizens and respect human rights, they breed anger and resentments that violent extremists exploit. Examples abound. Boko Haram gained traction in Nigeria after the government's security forces suppressed peaceful protests and executed the group's founder without trial. Al-Shabaab exploits heavy-handed tactics by the Kenyan security forces in its efforts to win over new recruits. It's its most effective recruiting tool. And in Afghanistan, the Taliban rails against government corruption. It did so before, and it does so now, in order to replenish its fighters every year. So how governments treat their citizens has a profound impact on the scope of the eventual terror threats they may face. So this, I want to argue, is not ideals value talk, but instead simply a factual assessment of the realities and interests at stake on the ground and over time. And while it's easy to get foreign governments to agree in theory to adopt a less militarized approach, in practice, it's very hard to change the way they act. U.S. counterterrorism policy, therefore, must include, and not just from the State Department voices, but from the voices of our intelligence community and our defense partners, our policy has to include pushing governments toward more accountable and inclusive governance in order to limit the grievances that fan radicalization to violence. And at a more technical and less controversial level, the United States and its partners can do much more to enhance state capacity to achieve these goals, training police, security forces, and the justice sector to be more responsive, proactive, and less corrupt, so that people are more inclined to trust these institutions so that they can in turn share information and flag threats and become safer. And similarly, we can help reform government policies that make the problem worse, like indiscriminate police sweeps that marginalize entire communities, foreign funding that amplifies voices of bigotry, unlimited detentions without charge or abuse in prisons. Again, the more technical fixes that have to go along with the policy advocacy. From Abuja to Astana, I've seen hopeful shifts in how government officials come to understand the impact of governance and rights in the context of terrorism. And sometimes I've been able to contribute to that change, as in helping prompt the police chief in Mombasa to re-examine widespread roundups of suspects, helping him understand that these tactics were actually creating great resentments and probably more terrorists. But the United States cannot be the sole source of persuasion or of capacity building in the global struggle against violent extremism. And fortunately, I can share that there's been progress mobilizing a broader range of actors in the international community to help advance a more multidimensional approach to counterterrorism. So earlier this year, the UN General Assembly endorsed the Secretary General's Plan of Action Against Violent Extremism, which emphasizes respect for human rights, good governance, and anti-corruption as powerful antidotes to terrorism. The UN has long had a counterterrorism strategy. What it didn't have was the emphasis on governance and the emphasis on community resilience and the emphasis on prevention that it has now endorsed through the General Assembly. So countries around the world are developing CVE or PVE national action plans that are intended to reflect these elements. And bodies like the UN Development Program and UNESCO are partnering with countries on the implementation of their national action plans. These steps are nascent, they're tentative, but they represent a recognition that it's not just ideology that leads individuals to violence, but also broader political, social, and economic factors as well. Now, states alone, and by this I mean the states in which communities exist, the states themselves, the national governments, are not the only ways to address community vulnerabilities and build community resilience. CVE emphasizes building community capacity and local level governance capacity to address these goals. What do I mean by that? Communities resilient to extremist messages are those in which local leaders, parents, and peers know how to spot and address signs of terrorist radicalization. There are communities in which mentors or institutions can offer powerful counterarguments and provide alternative paths for those most at risk. Where citizens, law enforcement, and local officials are bound by trust and cooperation. Where the vulnerable have outlets to enable a sense of purpose, community, or dignity, and where local voices, including women and youth, take the lead in speaking out against violent ideologies and propaganda. Where communities are able to build such resilience, terrorist groups will struggle to find new followers and safe havens. The United States' countering violent extremism efforts seek to build resilience in vulnerable communities globally. For example, U.S. Foreign Assistance supports networks of women and girls in South Asia to act when they see signs of terrorist radicalization in their neighborhoods. The United States helped to establish a strong cities network to connect mayors and local community leaders across the globe to exchange what works and what doesn't in stifling terrorist recruitment and strengthening communities. And the U.S. Global Engagement Center is empowering a broad network of positive messengers, non-governmental organizations, religious leaders, even former extremists, who can serve as credible local voices against violent ideologies. Now, some of these approaches will sound very familiar in an audience such as this one, because they evoke some of the practices and policies that have been associated with counterinsurgency and with stabilization operations, or with what many consider to be simply the fundamentals of effective governments and healthy communities. And that's because although we brand the terrorist threat differently, terrorism lives on the spectrum of conflict. And the last 15 years show clearly that the political, social, and economic aspects of conflict extend to terrorism. As much as we'd like to treat terror as a unique threat, violent extremists often exploit the same underlying discontents that fuel insurgencies, civil wars, and interstate conflicts. So therefore, an effective response must address these causes and not just the symptoms. Now, some CVE critics hear the word root causes and dismiss the approach altogether because they assume erroneously that CVE demands remaking the world. And obviously, no combination of interventions, whether by the Agency for International Development and the State Department, the European Union, the World Bank, the UN Development Program, no combination can address every factor that could potentially contribute to the spread of terrorism. From a counterterrorism perspective, the keys are 1, prioritizing the most vulnerable communities, 2, identifying the particular local, social, educational, political, economic, or security drivers of radicalization, and 3, addressing those drivers with programming and policies that work in an integrated way that include changing government actions that exacerbate radicalization. And this is an approach that we've just begun piloting this year in East Africa, aiming to prevent the spread of al-Shabaab recruitment and infiltration. Before launching our pilot, experts from across the government partnered to conduct extensive research, develop a common diagnosis of drivers, and design truly integrated programs to address the particular issues enabling radicalization to violence in the specific places that their research had identified as the most vulnerable to al-Shabaab recruitment and infiltration. At the same time, we engaged in intensive dialogue with the governments in the region about their policies and actions to ensure that, at a minimum, they're not making the terrorist problem worse. And we're trying to reinforce the impact of our own inherently limited efforts by coordinating with other partners like the World Bank. And we are hopeful that this can become the model for moving forward with preventing violent extremism. Over a decade after 9/11, the US has begun moving beyond its reliance solely on military force and reactive measures. By articulating and implementing a more proactive preventive policy for containing the spread of violent extremism, the US has also prompted the global community, from the UN and national development programs to the World Bank, to dedicate non-military resources and efforts toward addressing the underlying factors that render individuals and communities vulnerable. This is real progress, but as I said, it is tentative. It is a beginning. And like any policy that relies on funding from Congress and leadership from the executive branch, it will face renewed scrutiny in the years ahead. And because CVE is not a panacea, but a path forward, its proponents and practitioners must continue working to address questions about its effectiveness and impact. Many CVE skeptics focused on achieving short-term measurable results question whether we can justify or even measure the impact of preventive efforts. We shouldn't equate counterterrorism, intelligence, law enforcement, and military responsive to active terror threats with CVE. They're distinct, and CVE can't deliver the same results as military force. But as stated earlier, we've learned that we cannot win a fight against terrorism if the pattern of the last decade plus repeats itself. That is, wherever we find military success, the enemy moves and regroups and reforms and rebrands and returns on a larger scale to threaten US interests and those of our allies. We simply cannot afford to do nothing to prevent the next iteration or generation of terrorism. So skepticism about how to do CVE more effectively is appropriate and useful. But skepticism about the need to complement military efforts with non-military efforts is simply self-defeating, even if those military efforts ultimately. I'm confident we can get CVE right. In the East Africa pilot that I just mentioned, we've embedded a rigorous monitoring and evaluation metric, and we've made it a priority to strengthen all M&E in our broader CVE efforts going forward. We're mindful that our success hinges in large part on rigorous research and analysis, which are critical to ensuring that we mobilize the right tools for the right problems in the right places. And given the highly local dynamics of radicalization to violence, intensive micro-level research is essential. So to strengthen those efforts, we helped establish the Resolve Network, which stands for Researching Solutions for Violent Extremism, to connect local researchers to identify best practices for building resilience. And I certainly hope that MIT and other universities in this area can become a part of that effort. Secondly, we've begun increasing CVE funding at state, but resources remain highly limited. To give you a sense of the comparison over the last year, kinetic operations against Daesh in Iraq, Syria, and the Levant cost the US Treasury about $4 billion annually. By contrast, last year, the State Department and the Agency for International Development spent less than $200 million on CVE programs worldwide. And I recognize this is a little bit of an apples to oranges comparison, but it gives you a sense of the scale of the response versus the prevention investments. With respect to resources, I see tremendous opportunity to better align global investments on development with CVE. Because each year, the international community spends billions to build roads and hospitals, train law enforcement, and promote human rights. And please don't misunderstand me. These investments are essential. They make the world a better place. But many in the development community insist on a bright line between their work on the one hand, which they consider to be humanitarian in nature and pure in principle, and CVE on the other hand. They don't want development assistance undermined by considerations or sensitivity to security issues because they fear it will undermine the independence, the humanitarian character of their work. And I understand that reasoning, but I profoundly disagree. The threat of violent extremism is simply too great and resources too scarce, and the links between development, governance, and terrorism are too clear for our efforts to remain separate. By building schools, expanding opportunity, and empowering civil society in those areas that are most vulnerable to violent extremism, the international community is investing in a positive, proactive response to the nihilistic lure of violent extremist groups. Given the relative costs of prevention compared to the exorbitant costs of military responses after terror networks expand, we owe it to the taxpayers and communities around the world under threat to invest more in prevention. Finally, I do want to mention that there is a risk that countering violent extremism could become conflated with countering a single religion rather than countering violent ideologies and those who would act in their name. By painting all adherents with a broad brush, such an approach would both deprive us of the very partners we most need to help prevent the spread of violent extremism, and it would risk becoming a self-fulfilling prophecy by fueling division along religious lines. To strengthen credible groups and leaders outside government, we must reject needlessly fueling a clash of civilizations framing of the terrorist challenge. Because portraying the challenge as one against radical Islam risks forging common cause not only among disparate terror groups, but potentially across a wider swath of peaceful adherents of a venerated religion who experience this framing as a threat against their faith. We must not forget the lessons of the post 9/11 period. 15 years of fighting Al-Qaeda, Daesh, and its offshoots, we now, as an international community, are beginning to reckon with the limits of military force. And we're moving in early and nascent ways toward a smarter, more holistic approach. The shift remains fragile, and terrorists will continue to murder and maim. And the temptation may grow to ignore past lessons in favor of seeking short-term success. Yet we owe it to every serviceman and woman who has served and sacrificed in the fight against terror, and to all the young people who will live with the consequences of today's policy choices, to remember that preventing the next generation of terrorists is every bit as important as defeating the current threat. So thank you. That ends my remarks, and I look forward to your questions and a conversation. So please raise your hand or come to the mic. I guess there are two mics. You can come to the mics and identify yourself at the outset if you would. I think that would be helpful for everyone here today.
Great. Hi, my name is Jean Gilman. I'm at the Security Studies Program. I have a question for you. I'm going to just give you an analogy and then ask you more about the program that you've just described. When the Ebola outbreak struck in West Africa, there was great success in Sierra Leone in reducing the impact and communicating with local communities so that they could, in fact, fight the epidemic. And one of the ways in which they did it was social media, and they did it with movie stars. I know this sounds very strange, but I'm asking you the question. When you think about this issue of mobilizing local communities, I'm not talking about the states right now, but mobilizing the local communities, is there a room in there for social media, for popular stars, anybody who could influence young people the way, in fact, they did in Sierra Leone?
I mean, the short answer is yes. I mean, a great deal of what I didn't talk about today is the countering the ideology piece of the fight against terror, in which social media obviously figures prominently. But social media is one of the key ways that youth in particular find a voice, both within their hometowns, but also linking them across groups that are connected either by interest or by ethnicity or by educational focus or whatever it is that they're using to link themselves with. So absolutely, social media is critical in terms of providing counter messaging, but also in terms of providing basic information. The issue about local voices, incredible local voices, isn't limited just to religious leaders or traditional leaders. Increasingly, what we find is that particularly when you're trying to reach youth, you have to think a little bit outside the box in terms of who has credibility with the most at-risk populations. But having said that, it's very specific to the community or the country or even the particular threat that is seeking to make inroads. And so more often than not, it is the communities themselves that can identify the leaders in whatever fields they are, whether they are, you know, local musicians or whether they are poets or whether they are religious leaders. So absolutely, both social media and celebrities of varying kinds can be really important, both in reaching within communities and in connecting communities to one another. Yes, in the red shirt, please. Or orange.
Hi, I'm a graduate student in architecture and planning here at MIT. My question is about the role of sort of ecological conditions and the threat of sort of conflict and the drought in Syria in 2006 and to 2010 preceded the civil war and led to many millions of farmers sort of leaving their lands and migrating to the cities. And there's also an overall trend of sort of drying in the Eastern Mediterranean. So my question is about the extent to which environmental sort of resource management policies in combating terrorism.
It's a great question, and it's much broader than terrorism, as you well know, in just framing your question. I see this everywhere that I go, whether it's in Mali or whether it's in the Lake Chad Basin area, everywhere that there has been significant ecological disruption, whether it's been gradual or abrupt, and has an impact on people's ability to simply maintain their livelihoods, it's part of the fundamental root causes or drivers piece that we talk about when we say what makes a community vulnerable to radicalization, vulnerable to messages that it otherwise would reject. And clearly there's a huge role in environmental factors, in being part of that boiling cauldron of vulnerabilities that exists. The interventions that the timing and scale of the interventions for addressing the economic, the environmental drivers underneath are often on a scale that is not congruent with sort of the political demands for addressing needs of those populations. And so often we are seeing movement of peoples and addressing their needs elsewhere rather than necessarily getting at root causes. Obviously, also in many of these places, the conflict is still raging. So the connection is clear. The sequencing and prioritization of response is less clear. And again, will depend on the case. But you know, one of the most interesting things, whether you are looking at the history of Darfur or whether you are trying to understand, you know, how at the end of the day people will be able to return and reintegrate in Somalia, you are facing issues of climactic, you know, of environmental factors that provide real limits on, they're helping drive conflicts and their limits on creating post-conflict solutions. And so it's an area of enormous import. And I don't know that we've moved to have to integrate that understanding and those disciplinary responses yet into the conflict resolution field as fully as we need to. But thank you for being here today, because that's an important piece of that.
And just to follow up real quickly, like there are good examples in the region. The Jordan River Basin is sort of an example of cooperation between different states. Sure, there are also scarcity issues because of larger dynamics, but in the case of Syria, there was also like a very long history of mismanagement of water resources. So I guess my question is, do you feel like there are specific instances where there can be interventions, or is it too sort of broad and general to be...
Well, I mean, there's a huge difference between working in a country like Jordan, which is at peace, and trying to essentially, you know, reinvigorate and restock the Lake Chad. So I think it will depend. Again, I think your question suggests that the need to be thinking preventively as opposed to responsibly after massive deterioration is really strong, and that's a question of political will and resources, and it's a big question for us now. Thanks.
Yeah, I'm Henry. I'm a student.
Hi, Henry.
Is it cool if I ask two questions?
Well, I guess.
All right. I mean, that's not one of the questions. Two separate questions. All right. So I guess
you might have to remind me of one of them. That's
for
all.
For sure.
I just didn't bring my pen.
For sure. So I guess you sort of present the contrast between, you know, the United States and terrorism as sort of a binary, us versus them. But I mean, historically, if you look at the role of the United States in the formation of some of these terrorist groups that you're talking about, if you look at the Taliban, which we galvanized, you know, in the 80s to fight the Soviets, if you look at Al-Shabaab, which is debatably an extension of the government fragmentation that we perpetuated in Somalia in the 90s, if you look at ISIS, which is both a fragmentation of the Iraqi government from the Iraqi war and our effort to both sort of deconstruct and reconstruct it, as well as the galvanization of the Al-Qaeda stuff, all of which had noble intentions. So who's to say that this particular bout of noble intentions with CVE and PVE wouldn't create the same sort of incubation chamber effect with things?
Okay, so let me do that one, because that's a really long question with a lot of assumptions embedded in it, and I'm going to forget which ones I want to address and don't. So I would take issue with almost everything that you said, except that there's no question that the United States did support the precursors of the Taliban, right? But I don't think you can say that we created X or Y or Z precursors. What you can say, I think fairly, is that those groups emerged out of chaos in which we were implicated in some way by being a policy actor. I think that's fair. So I want to push back a little bit and just say we have to be careful as we talk about causality. But I think your broader question is when the United States fuels military tools and actors, can it exacerbate the problem of terrorism? And I would say absolutely, there's always that risk. But to answer your proximate question, which is how is CVE not like that or potentially like that, I would argue it's totally different than that, because CVE isn't about military responses. It's not about military actors. And in fact, it's trying to promote the state where it has a monopoly on violence and is using force against those it deems to be terrorists to be more respectful of human rights and disaggregate more carefully between political difference and the use of violence in its exercise of its security powers. So CVE is fundamentally about getting governments to be more restrained in how they use force, and it's fundamentally about trying to strengthen community voices and non-governmental actors in providing the cohesion that they can use to create possibilities so that a violent extremist recruiter doesn't look like a better option. So I would argue it's very different. And I would argue that the specifics of the question I found problematic. But I think the fundamental point, which is that military responses can backfire, I think history would bear you out on that.
Just as a follow-up, I mean, how do you...
So is this your second question, or is it a follow-up to the first?
This is a follow-up to the first. Okay. This is 1B.
Okay. I just want to make sure I'm with you in terms of where we are.
So, I mean, you know, obviously, idealistically, we go into these countries, and, you know, everything's cool, you know, and they abide by these restraints and these, you know, declarations of human sentiments that we try and, you know, give to them. But I mean, that in itself, you know, with sort of the UN and the US like overlooking countries and shaking their finger at them and stuff, has also proven itself to be...
I'm sorry, I'm not following you. What's your question?
I mean, so those efforts have also proven themselves to be somewhat ineffective. So how does that get enforced? The idea that, you know, it's the non-militaristic side of that.
So if I understand you correctly, what you're saying is when we ask governments to not be repressive in their use of force and to think about second and third order effects, what guarantees do we have that they're going to do what we say? We don't. Because governments are free to do what they want. But part of the art of diplomacy and part of the art of building relationships is to be honest when you think someone is digging their own hole. And that's fundamentally what that's about. So you're right, there are no guarantees. So you had a second question?
Do you believe that global terrorism exists? That is, do you believe that, you know, ISIS doing their thing and Boko Haram doing their thing in Nigeria and a guy in San Bernardino and we're trying to unlock his phone, do you believe that those are all tied into an agenda? That, you know, this global jihad thing that you're talking about.
My remarks was to try to suggest that if we overlook the local and specific motivations of those who use violence, we are missing an opportunity to prevent the spread of violence. So I see the threat as disaggregated, and I see tensions emerging in the competing camps that exist, and I see insurgencies that are flirting with affiliations and then backing away from them. So I think it's a very complicated global threat agenda. Thank you for the questions.
Jay Gleason, since the Office of Counterterrorism is in your division of the State Department, isn't it about time to take Hamas off the foreign terrorist organization list? They're a democratically elected government. There's no other countries in the world except Israel and Canada that list the full Hamas as a terrorist organization. The EU is in the process of delisting them. They have one final appeals court verdict to go on. Many of these FTO listings on the U.S. are completely out of step with the rest of the world, and they appear to be politically motivated. So when you go back to Washington, can you recommend to Obama to remove Hamas at least and begin this process of thinning out this FTO list that is really counterproductive and extremely unfair?
Thanks for the question. The designation of FTOs actually has a set of requirements that are based on facts that come from our intelligence community, and it is a pretty straightforward process. So the designation is unlikely to change until the behaviors that merited the designation in the first place change. And when they change, I'm confident that that responsible folks who will be in charge in future dates of looking at these issues will follow the law and designate as appropriate. But it's based on actions.
For us, but not for most of the majority of the countries in the world, don't agree with that.
Any other questions? Sorry, thank you.
My name is Ram Hamood Khan. I am a Humphrey Fellow at MIT. I belong to Pakistan and unfortunately to tribal area of Pakistan, Fata. My question is about the policy consistency of the US government against the terrorism. Because from history we know that the Afghan Mujahideen were helped by the US government as well as Pakistani government. But at some point in time, we left them unattended. And now, in this Al-Qaeda and Taliban scenario, we have almost won the war against them. The successful operation in Pakistan tribal areas, I think that is very safe in these days. But now it is the time, if the US policy changes again, and they revert back to their old practices, then what will happen? My question is about the consistency of policy on the part of the US government.
So thanks for the question, and it's a really interesting juxtaposition with the earlier question, which seemed to start from the premise that military engagement was problematic and could have negative second order effects. Your question is essentially saying where military progress is being made, if there is a change in policy and that progress is not sustained, doesn't that have negative consequences? And I think, you know, without prejudice to how it applies in a particular case, I think both things can be true. And so if the judgments that countries make about their foreign policy are rooted in self-interest, but as I tried to suggest in my remarks, I think we sometimes have very different time frames for thinking about self-interest and thinking about what constitutes success. And I do think there is a very important argument to be made that regardless of whether or not engagement is something that an individual supported or didn't support in its initial substantiation, that the failure to move beyond military force and consolidate goals with governance that is responsive, with the various social, political, economic pieces that can sustain military gains, I think many people would argue that that's another lesson that has haunted America in the course of its history. And I appreciate your question. This is now, I think, because there will be a new government transition, it will be an opportunity for a new administration to relook at assumptions and to potentially make different choices or to continue with policy. And it's very difficult to predict because decision making and timeframes and understandings of interest will differ. As much as we would like to believe that the nation state only has one clear interest and we're always a rational actor and we can predict it. So I guess what I would say is I can't tell you that there is consistency because circumstances change and political leadership changes and internal political dynamics change and external assessments change. So the dance between decisions about intervention initially and whether or not those are wise and warranted, and the decisions about how once an initial military commitment of some kind, whether it's direct intervention or proxy support or whatever it is solidified, I think these are two areas in which we will always have vigorous debate within the United States about what the right thing to do is. And I don't see that changing. The decisions by administration may be different, but I don't see the nature of that tension going away. I think that is likely to be an enduring feature of our foreign policy. Yes.
Actually, I hope you can hear me. Jim O'Brien's my name. I don't know how you do what you do, but how do you, it may be sort of a follow-up, but how do you balance the cultural differences within the countries we're talking about now that may be far different than what we believe is right or wrong here, with support for the central government, day-to-day, how do you do that? Obviously, your title is Civilian Security, Democracy, and Human Rights, and it sounds like something that is a balancing act. So how much you take into account what their culture dictates their norms to be, what we believe they maybe could be improved, and of interaction with the central governments to address those issues?
It's a really good question, and it's different depending on the context. I mean, maybe just to take the example of Afghanistan, I mean, some things are enduring. So for example, the United States has long prided itself on its vision of itself as a nation in which individual rights are protected and individuals are central to governance, and there's a voice for citizens in governance. There's also an international body of fundamental human rights that we can rely on that is different from our own national experience and preferences, but that creates sort of the framework for discussion with countries about what is, in a non-US way, but in a more abstract and universal way, the expectation of what it means to govern and what the rights of the citizens are. And then there are the particular characteristics of a given government, or in some cases, the particular practices in a given society that are in tension with either the US sort of version or the universal version. So for example, in Afghanistan, one of the signal effects of the US invasion and the subsequent shepherding in of an Afghan government was to encourage them to create a constitution in which women's rights were recognized in a way that was fundamentally different from the way in which they had been recognized legally in Afghanistan or the way in which they had been experienced culturally throughout the country. And this is another example of tension because, you know, to me, that's an unalloyed good. But there's no question that for those that were using ideologies in which the subjugation of women was central, it gave them a different tool to use. So you're right. There is a constant balancing act between what is the right thing to do from one perspective and what is effective policy in the long term, again, depending on what your goals are. And I think those are also likely to be in tension in much of the world that isn't in the same space that the U.S. is when it thinks about its own human rights values and democratic values, or when it understands the UN, the international universal values. If a country comes from a very different place, either because it's got a different political system or a very different set of cultural practices, there will be tensions between what we seek to promote from the United States perspective or even from a universal perspective and what will be perceived as legitimate or welcome by a majority or even a minority within that country. So balancing act is a nice way to put it.
Hi, I'm student course 5 here at MIT. I have a question that's probably going to warrant a follow-up question. So the initial question is, how are you defining this sort of like buzzwords that you've been using in your remarks about what is a vulnerable community? How are you defining that?
Great. So what we did in the case of the East Africa pilot, which is the most concrete example that I can give you, is we looked at the historical pattern of al-Shabaab's recruitment. And we looked at where it had moved, and we looked at who it had recruited, and we looked at the arguments that it had been using and the incentives that it had been using. And we deduced from that where the most vulnerable places were. Now, some of them were geographically accessible. Some of them were communities of faith that had experienced great disruption, whether it was whether they had been moved, they were actually IDPs. They no longer were in their homes, and they were vulnerable in those ways with all the attendant consequences, or whether they were part of a community that had been marginalized by the government, shaken down by the police constantly, and therefore really distrustful of state authority and quite eager to find alternatives. So that's what I mean by a vulnerable community, communities that are at risk for recruitment or for infiltration by terror actors. And the best way to do that is to understand what those actors have already done, because that gives you insights into the way that they operate and therefore who they will target next. So that's what, by vulnerable, that's what is meant.
So then the follow-up question is, how do you reconcile communities that are being made vulnerable by acts the U.S. is involved in, ongoing communities that are the community in Gaza, for example, that's just going to be vulnerable for there's no end in sight there. And the U.S. has a direct hand in making these people a vulnerable community. So how do you how do you balance or reconcile the idea that, on the one hand, we are creating vulnerable communities day by day in the world, and then on the other hand, we are trying to empower and predict where these vulnerable communities are going to pop up next, I guess, is the question.
So this is not dissimilar to an earlier question about the second order effects of U.S. foreign policy and where and how we can or should reasonably be expected to understand that they create different kinds of problems. What I'm talking about in the context of the countering violent extremism approach, which is what I have been seeking to inculcate at the State Department, is how do we use the limited foreign assistance tools that we have and policy interventions that we have to contain growing terror threats by protecting generations, the youth in particular, from being drawn to radical propaganda. This is not something that you can necessarily do everywhere around the globe. And part of the reason why it's so important that there is an international understanding of both the actions of states and their second order effects, and the ways to use traditional development tools to build community resilience is because the needs are so great. So if you use a very ecumenical definition of who's vulnerable, you would say, you know, more than half the globe is vulnerable. But the vulnerabilities that I'm talking about are quite specific to a particular terrorist group and its recruitment and infiltration practices.
Hi, good evening. George Besige from Germany. I'm visiting a scientist. May I ask you to speculate, which is a question which is most interesting to us Europeans, about the upcoming changes? Are there some under the new president-elect, under the from a U.S. perspective, and also concerning the European perspective?
I am a U.S. government official standing before you, and so I will not speculate, period, and I will certainly not speculate on things political. But thank you for the question. I mean that with respect, but... Yes.
My name is George Mokra. I'm an independent scholar from Central Square. In my readings over the past few years, I've been kind of surprised about the lack of attention paid to the Caliphate movement in the 20s, which talked about rebuilding the caliphate and how that might relate to what the situation is happening now, and also about the lack of mention for Abdul Ghaffar Khan, and also known as Bacha Khan, who founded the Servants of God, what some people call the world's first nonviolent army. So that's one thing. And I would advise you to take a look at those kinds of things. In my readings, I think it was, there's a Chinese saying, an old shame becomes, let me see, an old shame becomes anger. And I think it's Louise Richardson in one of her books talks about humiliation as being a driver for terrorism. And I think it's Jessica Stern who's talking in her book, Terror in the Name of God. There is a quote from a Kashmiri terrorist that she interviewed. And she asked him, how do we change this? And his answer was free secular literacy for all. So I'm wondering about that. I'm wondering about the ability to do free secular literacy for all, given the kind of technologies that we have available, given the kinds of things with MITx, HarvardX, edX, all of that, cell phones, and the idea of humiliation and old shames becoming anger.
So thanks. I think education is clearly a key to all kinds of addressing all kinds of problems, to include violent extremism. One of the more interesting and dynamic institutional innovations has actually been at UNESCO, which was, you know, in the eyes of many, a rather moribund international organization for some time. But it has spent a lot of time in the last couple of years developing educational materials for teaching tolerance awareness, essentially helping give kids the tools that they need to understand the difference between a message of harmony and a message of division. More broadly, secular education has been pointed to by many national leaders as being a key element of their national response to violent extremist propaganda. The more narrow issue of even skills and vocational training is something that is, in the shorter term, even more accessible as a way of helping to strengthen resilience within communities. But critical thinking is believed by many who have studied the spread of violent extremist ideology to be absolutely critical. But you undoubtedly know that is a longer term and really daunting effort. But the advantage of places like UNESCO coming up with essentially tools that can be used, whether it's in a madrasa or whether it's in a daycare center or whether it's at home, can be used at the local level by relatively unskilled mentors or people who are in a teaching role, even if they're not formally trained as teachers, I think is a really important step toward trying to address the shorter term needs that are out there. So thank you for the question. Yes.
Oh, hi, thank you. My name's James. I live here in Cambridge. My uncle was the U.S. ambassador to the Sudan back when people called it the Sudan. I've also had the pleasure of meeting some great people of conscience over the years who've resigned from the State Department at various times. My niece did her dissertation on Somali refugee population, mainly in Lewiston, Maine, just by way of introduction. I find myself, some of the questions we're getting at, a concern that I have, and it has partly to do with sort of the discourse about terrorism and violence. But there's a more specific follow-up to this. But I'm mindful of the famous words of Martin Luther King when he gave his speech at Riverside Church a year to the day before he was assassinated, where he called the United States the greatest purveyor of violence in the world today. And it makes me want to say, if you really want to do something about violent extremism or violent terrorism, you know, we all ought to do more to get our government to stop being as violent as it is all over the world and in this country. I find myself thinking of the numbers of black males, unarmed black males, who've been gunned down, shot in the back by law enforcement, so-called, in this country over many months. Obviously, that's not the whole story all the time. But I want to get at something specific, which is Saudi Arabia and Israel. You said that we really can't do much, but I don't think that's true, because the United States supports politically and militarily both Israel and Saudi Arabia with billions of dollars in military aid, strong political support, and one could make an argument that that's a place where some attention is, especially if you're going to talk about particular forms of terrorist organizations like Al-Qaeda or other organizations that are demonstrably supported by Saudi, the Saudi government in ways that are maybe somewhat less than obvious and transparent, but I think there's considerable evidence for some of that. So given that, why doesn't the U.S. do more? Why doesn't our government do more about the Saudi government and their involvement in terrorism and their support for terrorist ideologies? And one could ask similar questions about Israel in a somewhat different way. Don't we have some tools that aren't being used to get those two governments to change how they treat their own citizens, their neighbors, and the role they play in instigating and providing fodder, propaganda fodder, for the kinds of terrorists that you're focusing on?
So thanks for that. I do want to, just because this is being recorded, I do want to point out that I didn't say we couldn't do anything. I said that there were, in response to the question, I said that there were no guarantees that when a state expressed its view of what was in the self-interest of another state, that the other state would take that into account. I think that's quite different. So I did just want to clarify that. Your question is fundamentally about using a broader range of tools and potentially jeopardizing entire relationships in the name of changing specific behaviors. And we talked earlier about the kinds of tensions that are enduring in American foreign policy, when and how to use force internationally, when you have used force, what are your obligations to build peace, and when can you or should you, when is the right moment to disengage, and what do you need to leave behind? This is another example of exactly such a tension, where there are a variety of reasons why in country X or country Z, we provide support. And some of those will have roots in our domestic politics, and some of those will have roots in particular goals that we have that are independent of a counterterrorism agenda. And so the executive branch has to weigh to what extent they use what pressure, to what extent the different goals compete against one another, and what are the core interests at stake in the relationship. So I think that's the short answer to your question. I will say that, you know, the United States has long made it plain that and pushed the Saudi government and seen some progress from the Saudi government about the need to A, not have state-sponsored support for the spread of violent extremism, but also to clamp down on private support for radical ideologies globally. And again, you get back into the line between what it means to do, for example, support in providing education for people in, say, Indonesia by building a madrasa and a mosque that goes with it, versus what constitutes private support for radical extremism. And I think there is more that we can do to help countries build capacities to make those distinctions and track them. But we've been working on terror finance for a long time, and it's a significant challenge. So this is not an issue that has gone unaddressed and that we have not, as a country, made our views very clear on. But I do think that there are both questions about prioritization of relative issues in terms of being willing to potentially jeopardize entire relationships.
Which was linked to an earlier question. With the list of supporters of terrorism, sponsors of terrorism, mm-hmm. and you were suggesting that it's simply a matter of fact, but some of what you said just
now... What I just said is that we
sounds
had...
Sounds like there's more going on than just an objective assessment of whether there's support.
I disagree with that fundamentally. I mean, the Saudi government is not a state sponsor of terrorism in the context of the state providing money to terrorist organizations. That doesn't mean that there aren't flows of money that come from private individuals within the country, in the same way that the U.S. had many private funds going to organizations that were radical, that weren't of an extremist variety internationally. So, I mean, there's a difference between what is a state activity and what are private activities that we would hope could be better controlled by the state. And we have work to do on that in our own country as well.
Okay. I was curious what you think of the role for the work you're doing is a difficult balancing act. Essentially, it's sort of fighting terror with kind of humanitarian programs. Between that and kinetic warfare, there's sort of economic sanction, there's kind of legal or lawfare. I guess what might be the proper balancing act between kind of all these various tools, and is the do you think the United States has that balance right?
Well, no, I think what I'm suggesting is that we have a way to go in terms of what most people would consider to be balance. If you look at, you know, $4 billion for current operations and a handful of theaters versus 200 million for global countering violent extremism efforts, which includes everything under the sun, right? So that includes both counter messaging work, that includes development work, that includes community resilience work, that's everything. So I'm not suggesting that there's a balance. I think, you know, one of the pieces that you mentioned is the use of sanctions. One of the difficulties, and this relates to the earlier question, is that terror organizations may be laundering money, they may be using banks, but by and large, they are not the kind of state actor that we're used to dealing with in terms of either the legal authorities for the use of sanctions or the mechanics of actually identifying the data that we use to make the case for sanctions and then implementing them. So there's been a steep learning curve even on some of the non-military but still coercive or law enforcement style tools that we can use against terror networks. We're doing a better job of it, but it's a cat and mouse game, just like, you know, the counter messaging and the use of social media is a cat and mouse game. You can take down anything that you want, but it'll pop up back in another phase. You close this bank, it reroutes there. You know, if you're not doing banks, maybe you're using donkeys. I mean, it's tough. It's a very micro analytic challenge that requires an enormous amount of effort to get it right. And so it's been a big piece of why this has been such a difficult challenge for the United States, because militarily it's different and it's hard. And then across the spectrum elsewhere, the scope is just enormous. And the micro specificity of what one needs to conduct an effective counter campaign, whether it's at the social political sort of resilience level or whether it's just in terms of terror financing, is pretty daunting. And so I'm very proud of the progress that has been made in many of those spheres, but there's much more work to be done.
Well, if there's no more questions, I just want to thank one more question. Okay.
Hi, Kevin Klinsky. I work here over at MIT. I was curious, it seems like there's much the emphasis on the extreme Islamic terrorism, but when we look at something like Mexico that's right on our southern border, the narco-terrorism seems to be a very violent occurrence down there, and it also seems like it's a little bit more normalized to say that we're used to shootings, we're used to bombings, we're used to things that may be considered more of an internal security problem for Mexico. But we're, as far as the U.S. as a country that's on our border, it doesn't seem to be in the news as much or as much of a focus. So I was curious about that, how we're more focused on what's going on in the Middle East as opposed to what's on, you know, our own hemisphere here.
And I think it's a really good question, and it gets to this issue of relative risk and what makes us feel like we are threatened or what makes us feel like we are secured, right? We're not in Mexico, so we're not experiencing those levels of violence. We're not in El Salvador. We're not experiencing those levels of violence. The terror threat, many would argue, has been because it has come home in very violent episodes, looms larger in both the public imagination and in the national security response than simply a historical accounting of the number of deaths, as tragic and awful as each one is, would suggest. What I would say is that what's interesting about the way we think about the movements of peoples from Central America to the United States, and here I'm talking less about Mexico and more about sort of the Northern Triangle, the Guatemala, El Salvador, and Honduras, the levels of violence there are significant. The levels of movement here are significant. What are we trying to do? We're trying to build community resilience, help governments build community resilience in those states so that there's less movement. So there are analogs between responses to these kinds of essentially traumas, and there are very different lenses that we put on describing the nature of the violence, in part because we fear longer-term implications of one in a different way, or we see immediacy of response in a different way than we do when we look at violence elsewhere. I mean, there are plenty of other examples besides Mexico, right? I mean, everywhere. There are so many examples where violence for civilians is at a very high level, but we don't necessarily have the response that we've seen. But what's interesting to me is that the solutions are probably not, that there are common elements of solutions that relate essentially to creating peaceful environments in which people can thrive, right? I mean, that's not the rocket science piece. And so this question about how do you identify a vulnerable community, there are vulnerable communities across the globe. And the prioritization that we've given to the war on terror, in part because we've experienced it directly and we view it as a problem that continues to grow and that can threaten many of our interests, not just our homeland, but our allies and regional stability, that has given us sort of a frame and a mechanism, but it's not unique. And I would suggest that the Central American migration problem and response shows some of those parallels. But you're right. There, if one were to say simply that it was levels of violence against civilians, we might disaggregate the globe in a different way. But we come at it through the terror frame because of its potential implications.
Yeah, and there's a quick follow-up to that. That's probably what it looks like Syria, because those people aren't leaving to go and flood Europe or come to the United States because the violence is impacting them directly over there.
Oh, one more. Go ahead.
Yeah. I hope this isn't too far out of your area of expertise, but I was sort of curious about the similarities and differences between trying to stop terrorism, whether it's trying to de-radicalize people or make communities more peaceful, when it comes to issues that we have here in America ourselves, whether it's, police using force too much or far-right people distrusting the government too much. What would you say to an argument of, if we can't get our own problems right, how are we going to do it around the world? Not that I necessarily doubt that we can.
So one of the things that I think we're grappling with, well, first of all, I probably shouldn't answer this question in the same frame that I just said before, but I guess what I would say is that one could argue that there are analogs, which is to say the use of state violence has to be restrained. And there is a conversation now in the United States that's a different conversation than there used to be about that, that echoes some of what I've talked about in terms of the kinds of conversations that we have about second and third order effects with other states. And the notion of healthy communities, again, I think the fundamental point is that it's not rocket science that if your community is healthy and people feel like they have a future and they have agency and they can have a livelihood and they can have dignity, that they are less likely to be to become suicide bombers. I mean, this is not a deep insight. And so I think there are analogs. And I guess I'll leave it there, but thank you. And thank you all for coming and for staying. And I've really enjoyed being here. And I wish you all a very happy Thanksgiving.